love you.
Oh, thank you so very much to our Fountain Singers. You did nothing more than express our hearts. God, I love you forever. I love you forever. Our call to worship for this Palm Sunday are these words. God is all life. God, soaring music and falling rain. Springtime joy and evening rest. Children's laughter. Loud hosannas. God of all life. Our journey and our home. Restless searching, gracious finding, Lenten mysteries, Easter hopes, God of all life, your praise we sing and offer you our lives. May we bow our heads in prayer. Gracious God, we invite you even the more on this service of worship on this Palm Sunday. We come singing our own hallelujahs and hosannas. So God, we invite you to take control of all that we say and do even the more. And then after having been here, may we indeed say it was good to be here today. These and all other blessings we ask in that name that's above every name, Jesus the Christ, our Savior. Amen, amen, and amen. Come on, Fountain Singers, bless our hearts again with another selection.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. We've come this morning to give God the glory, the honor, and the praise, for truly he deserves it all. He's been good to us, so much better than we deserve. Yeah, he deserves our praise. Listen.
My hallelujah belongs to you. My hallelujah belongs to you. Yeah.
My hallelujah belongs to you. I don't know about you, but Jesus, you have my hallelujah and my hosanna. Boy, I don't know what we would be doing if we were back in that day with those disciples. I don't know if we'd be throwing down palm branches, throwing down our outer tunics, our coats. But all I know is hallelujah belongs to him. God bless you. Good morning again. I'm Pastor Paul L. Anderson. It's such a blessing to be in the Lord's house on this Palm Sunday to tell him thank you for the wonderful things he's done for us all and for making his way to Calvary. You know, today is such a powerful day. It's Palm Sunday. But it's also April the 10th. April the 10th is the celebration for my dad's birthday. My dad is now in heaven. Today he would be celebrating with us, if he was here on earth, his 100th birthday. But I'm just so grateful that God blesses us and calls us all home. And my mom, I'm sure they're probably having a great time up there. Today, it's always in our family. It is so interesting. People always have birthdays on the same day. It's also my mother's sister, Aunt Lucy. Aunt Lucy Kofor Heath, she celebrates her 94th birthday today, the only living sister of all my mom's sisters and my brother. She's the only one here. We're so grateful for precious memories like today. A day like Palm Sunday, a day on this weekend that we celebrate Jesus making his triumphal entry into Jerusalem. I'd like to read for you today the scripture that comes out of the Gospel according to St. Luke, verses the 19th chapter, verses 28 through 40. I'm going to read this little small pericope that you might get the full gist of the story. After telling this story, Jesus went towards Jerusalem, walking ahead of his disciples. As he came to the town of Bethpage and Bethany of the Mount of Olives, he sent two disciples ahead of him. "Go into the village over there," he told them. "As you enter it, you will see a young donkey tied that no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks, 'Why are you untying that colt?' just say, 'The Lord needs it.'" So they went and found the colt just as Jesus had said. And sure enough, as they were untying it, the owner asked, "Why are you untying that colt?" And the disciples simply replied, "The Lord needs it." So they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their garments over it for him to ride on. As he rode along, the crowd spread out their garments on the road ahead of him. And when he reached the place where the road started down the Mount of Olives, all the followers began to shout out and sing as they walked along, praising God for the wonderful miracles they had seen. "Blessings on the King who comes in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven." But some of the Pharisees among the crowd said, "Teacher, rebuke your followers for saying things like that." He replied, "If they keep quiet, the stones along the road will burst out in cheers." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be unto God. May we pray. Father, we pray that the words of our mouth and the meditations of our heart would be acceptable unto thee. O Lord, our strength and our redeemer, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, and amen. For the next few moments, I want to talk about blessings on the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessings on the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Our text on today is very powerful. It's a message that comes to us through and by Luke. You know Luke. Luke was that one who was known as the great physician. Luke was one of those disciples that was handpicked by Jesus. Luke was the one who chronicles for us and gives to us so many wonderful narratives of all the things that he knew and knows about Jesus, all the things he heard and had seen. And on today, like no any other day, he begins to tell us what Jesus is doing. Jesus has just finished telling a story to his disciples. And now, as he goes towards Jerusalem, walking ahead of his disciples, notice it lets us see that Jesus is walking to Jerusalem slightly ahead of his disciples. That's because he was the leader. He was a little bit ahead of them. They were following. But Jesus does something so powerful. He sends two of the disciples, as Jesus always does. He sends them out by twos. He even tells us that even began their ministry. He sends them out by two, and he makes sure that they always have someone beside them to be their companion, someone to encourage them, someone to watch while they're talking, someone to pray while they're engaging in activities. He sends out two, and he says to them, as you go to this city, you will find there's a young donkey, a little colt, a foal, one that has never been ridden upon. You'll find it tied. And when you find it there tied, as you unloosen the tie, someone who will say to you, why are you untying that colt? You will tell them the Lord has need of it. Just as Jesus said, secondly, he tells them just what they needed to know. They get to the place where they find the colt. They untie it. The owner says, why are you untying this colt? And they said, the Lord has need of it. That lets us see anytime Jesus asks for something, you can't help but give it to him. Aren't you happy that he asks us for our time? He asks us for our lives. He asks us for all the gifts and talents he's given to us to be used for his glory. And we always respond with a hearty, yes, Lord, whatever you tell me to do, I'll do it. So we find now here in the text, it begins to help us to see, and we begin to understand that as they untie the coat, and as they begin to lead the colt to the place where it needs to be to meet Jesus, when they untie him, when they loosen him, and when they put their garments on him, they take him to where Jesus is. Jesus reminds them, this is a colt that no one has ever ridden on before. That lets us see that Jesus always does what no one else has ever done before. Throughout his life, throughout his ministry, he does what no one else has ever done before. And on this Palm Sunday, I hope you and I will have a moment, a time in our lives that Jesus will do for us what no one else has ever done before. May he speak to our lives like no one else has ever done before. May we be open to allow him to have free reign in our lives like no one else has ever done before. Our text lets us see that his disciples, as they're doing what Jesus has asked them to do, and I think it's purely because they have already surrendered to him at this moment. When you and I surrender to Almighty God, whatever he asks us to do, it always turns out just like he said it would. Today, if you haven't received Christ as your Lord and Savior, you ought to surrender to him today, and it will be just like he said it would be. So we find in the text, Jesus is with his disciples. He's already engaged in dialogue. He's now on a road. He's slightly ahead of his disciples. He sends two disciples ahead of him. They get the coat. They identify where it is. They have just what Jesus wanted them to have. All of the ingredients of being willing to trust and obey. My brothers and sisters, in all of our lives, there are always great songs that have been penned to help us to make sure that we're following Christ every step of the way. The great hymnologist wrote a song, "The only way to be happy in Jesus is to trust and obey." They were willing to obey what Christ had said. They trusted in his word, and it comes to pass. In all of our days, in all of our lives, especially on this Palm Sunday, all we have to do is learn to trust and obey. We see all the things that have happened with our brothers and sisters in Europe. We must teach them, and we must too, trust and obey. Trust in the word of God. Obey what Christ has said for us to do, and it will come to pass. We see all that's happened in the world. We've seen all the tornadoes that have happened. We've seen all of the inclement weather. As you know, we're in that tornado portion of the year. We must learn to trust and obey. And it will be just like God said it would be. He promised the righteous would never be forsaken, nor their seed begging for bread. In our text today, these disciples are doing something that they have been given the power to do, and that is follow the commandment of the Lord. Today, God gives us very similar commandments, and that is to trust and obey him. Whatever he's written in his word, that's what we must learn to do. The text helps us to see that as they get to the coat to where Jesus is, they throw their garments on the coat to try to ease those bones that the coat has. You know, oftentimes whenever you and I are riding beasts of burdens, we're riding colts, we're riding donkeys, we're riding horses. In our contemporary day, we put a saddle on them. But this was before they had saddles. They would throw garments over them to make the road a whole lot smoother, to make the way so you wouldn't feel every step of the colt. So Jesus now finds himself at the place where he's getting on this colt, this small little beast, this beast that has the wonderful privilege of walking into Jerusalem, carrying the Messiah on his back. You know, whenever you and I read this passage, it reminds us we must take the message of the Lord wherever we go. But it's a good thing to do to take it while we're young. This little young colt, as he's guided, he brings Jesus to the place where he needs to be. Don't you know that we should guide our children the same way, that they will carry the Lord with them everywhere they go? I always remember the words of my mom and my dad and all of our family. When we get ready to leave each other, we say, take the Lord with you everywhere you go. In this passage, we begin to see that the disciples are taking Jesus with them everywhere they go. When you and I take the Lord with us everywhere we go, it is then that we will find out the road is a whole lot smoother. You'll find out that the travel time is a whole lot shorter. When we take the Lord with us everywhere we go, it is then the world will know that we have shown up and that we have come to talk about the one who is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. A text on today reminds us, blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Jesus is now about to enter into Jerusalem. Remember, he's done miracles after miracles. He has done his very first miracle. He turned water into wine. He has healed Jairus' daughter. He has called all of those persons who were found themselves affirmed and found themselves infirmed and found themselves being the outcast. He has healed the lepers. He has given sight to the blind. He has told those who had no hope, you now have new hope. This is the man that everybody starts to follow. See, the piece that you and I have to remember is that this was during the season of Passover. Jesus is now about to go into the place of the city whereby they're getting ready to celebrate the Feast of the Unleavened Bread. Jesus is now getting ready to enter. And as he is coming into this city, everybody has great hope. They have great anticipation and they have great wonder and amazement because they knew that Jesus was riding on a donkey. They knew he was going to make his entry into the city. And as they see him coming, they begin to think about the words of prophecy that, behold, there comes one who is going to be riding on a donkey, the one who will be the King, the one who will be the Lord of Lords. And so now they are all excited because they believe that this is going to be the Messiah. This is going to be the one during this week of the unleavened bread, this week of the festival. This will be Jesus making his announcement of his new kingdom. I can't help but think about the anticipation that they had, that everybody was pushing their way to the front. They were saying, get out the way. I want to get to the front. And as they were telling everybody, get out the way. I want to make my way to the front. I want to be the first one to see him as he comes into the city. Couldn't you just imagine the press? It's almost like the carousel parade that we have in Raleigh. It's almost like the Christmas parade in Charlotte. It's almost like the Macy's Day parade. It was a parade where you had people from all over coming because everybody came to the celebration, this feast of the Passover. It was an annual pilgrimage that people would make to thank God for what he has done for their ancestors, how he brought them out of Egyptian bondage and captivity, and how he is now taking them to the place of celebration. So now Jesus is making his way into the city. And as he's riding along, people do something in the way that they would do for a king that is coming in after a victory. They take off their outer garments. They throw them on the road. They were taking palm branches. They were throwing them down in the street. This was the way that a king entered into the city. This is the way that someone who had just won a military battle would come in for them to celebrate the victory. Oh, but don't you know there was a victory? There was a spiritual victory that they all knew about. That this is Jesus, the King of Kings. This is Jesus, the Lord of Lords. And as he makes his way into the city, everybody is not happy. You know, when Jesus does what he does, everybody is not happy. I remember we used to sing this song, "Ain't nobody mad but the devil. Ain't nobody mad but the devil. And if you are mad, you must have the devil inside of you." We already know that there was one of his disciples that later on we will find out about, Judas Iscariot. He's the one that the devil is working on his heart, as in a few days he's about to do something that he didn't know really what he was doing. I don't believe. I think he thought he may have been forcing the hand of Jesus to show them just who he was. But Jesus is now making his triumphal entry into Jerusalem. And those who were watching him, the Pharisees, they were saying, "Teacher, rebuke your followers. Tell them to stop making all this noise. You're not the king of our day." But Jesus tells them, "I'm not about to do that." Aren't you happy when we know who Jesus is? We can't help but make a lot of commotion and tell the world that he is the King of Kings. He is the Lord of Lords. He is the Savior of my life. He is the Son of God. He is the seed of David. He is that long time coming King that we've been waiting for. And he is here right now. Can't you imagine the songs that we sing in our worship services today? He's here right now. He's the King of Kings. He's the Lord of Lords. When you and I know who he is, we can't help but celebrate. Here in the passage, they believe him to be the one who's going to redeem Israel. They believe him to be the new king. And now the Pharisees don't like it. They're saying, "You need to tell your followers, you need to tell all these people to be quiet because they're trying to make you into somebody that you are not." Well, there's always some Pharisees in our lives. There's always people who are telling us to be quiet. You're making too much noise. But when you think about the goodness of Jesus and all that he has done for us, you and I both can't help but cry out, "Hallelujah, I thank you for saving me." Here in the passage, we find out the Pharisees tell him, "Tell your people to be quiet." Jesus says something that is so much more powerful than you and I would ever glean. He says, "If they be quiet, the rocks will cry out." Now, I don't know about you. I've never heard any rocks talk. I've never heard any rocks cry out. And it might be because you and I have good enough sense that we know that we ought to give the praise to whom the praise is due. Somebody said all of our praise belongs to him because he's the King of Kings. He's the Lord of Lords. He's the fairest of 10,000. He is the one that'll make a way out of no way. He is that lily in the valley. He's the bright and morning star. And we know he's our King of Kings and he's our Lord of Lords. Jesus tells the Pharisees that if these people be quiet, the rocks will cry out and can't help but tell them who he is. Why? Because he is the rock of all ages. Jesus was here before any rocks were ever created because he was a part of the creation process with God. In essence, they were saying, Blessings on the King who comes in the name of the Lord, because this is our King. Jesus is my King. I don't know who he is to you, but I know to me he is my King. He is the one that saved my soul. He's the one that's about to go to Calvary's cross. He's the one that is going to be hung, bled, and died and be resurrected on Sunday morning. But since today is Palm Sunday, we must spend our time to worship, to praise him. Let's throw down our clothes. Let's throw down our palm branches and make way for the Lord to come. Let his way be smooth. Let his way be easy. Let him know that he is welcome. You know, figuratively in all of our lives, we need to take off those things that get between us and God. Lay them down at the feet of Jesus because they are not worth enough for us to put in front of him. But when we throw down our palm branches, when we put our clothes in the walkway, it's our way of saying, "Ride on, King Jesus, because no man cannot hinder you. Ride on the one who is going to be the lily in my valley, the one who always is my bright and morning star." In the passage, we can't help but let the world know as we see that Jesus is our King. He's the King that comes in the name of the Lord. He's the one that doesn't call us into a physical battle, but he calls us into a spiritual battle because he has the keys of death, hell, and the grave in his hand. And because of the power and the might that's in his hand, you and I ought to praise him like never before. The hymnologist said, praise him in the morning, praise him in the noonday, praise him in the evening, praise him when the sun goes down. So let's praise the Lord on this Sunday, this Palm Sunday, as we are wearing the palms to tell everybody he is my King of Kings. He is my Lord of Lords. He is the one that was promised to us from the beginning of time, the one who will redeem us from all of our sins. He is the Lion of Judah. He is the one who is promised from Almighty God. Today, if he is not the king in your life, all you have to do, the words of a song says, Lord of my life, I crown thee now. Thine shall the glory be. Let him be the king of your life. Simply by saying, Father, forgive me of my sins. I accept the work that Jesus did for me at Calvary. I thank you that all my sins have been washed away and I've been redeemed. And if you've prayed that prayer and been redeemed, we love to be a blessing to you as we will bless God. Today, if you've prayed that prayer, email us and let us know you've done it. You may email us at join@thefountainofraleigh.org to let us know you have joined the body of Christ. You've joined the family of God. And we'd love to have you join our fellowship. And also, we want to pray with you and send your prayers by emailing us at prayer@thefountainofraleigh.org. We want to pray with you and pray for you because we want to remind us all that blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. He is our Lord and our Savior. May God bless you on this Palm Sunday. May you worship and glorify him like never before. May we bow our heads in a word of prayer. Father, we come to lift up all of those who have said, please pray for me. Father, we lift up those who have been in moments and times in which they have been on their beds of affliction, those who've had surgery, those who are healing from cancer, those who are recuperating from having organ transplants. Thank you for healing and redeeming us. Father, we say thank you for those who have renewed hope and strength in you and in your word. Now, Father, we pray that your spirit will lead, guide, and abide with us and keep us until we meet again. Now unto him, the great shepherd who gave his life for the sheep. May the Lord bless, preserve, and keep you from the rising of the sun to the going down of the same. May he bless you in your leisure, your labor, your joys, and your sorrows and give you hope for today and tomorrow. Father, bless your people all over the world. Bless every land, every country, every elected official. Keep them strong in you. And Father, those who need added strength, do it for them too. Now we thank you for these and all other blessings. We ask in the name that's above every name, Jesus the Christ, our Savior. And it's in his name we pray. Amen, amen, and amen. God bless you. And always remember, you are exceedingly and abundantly blessed. And we'll see you all tomorrow.
To sow a seed to the Fountain of Raleigh Fellowship, visit our newly redesigned website, thefountainofraleigh.org, and select Sow a Seed from the homepage. Also, giving has been made easier with the new Fountain of Raleigh app, available now in the Apple App Store and Google Play Store. Download today, select Giving from the main menu, and then follow the directions to complete your giving through Subsplash.
Thank you so very much for all of your gifts and donations that you've given to the Fountain of Raleigh Fellowship. We thank you for what you've done in the past, what you're currently doing, and what you will do in the future. Your gifts and donations helps us to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ, not only locally, but throughout the world. Thank you again for your gifts, and may God continue to richly bless you. It is here at the Fountain that we believe that we are exceedingly and abundantly blessed, and may you receive those blessings that God has in store for you. Okay.